हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक टू माय चैनल एमयू एग्जाम्स। टुडे आई एम बैक विद अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन, दैट इज एक्सप्लेन हाउ द मेन इंजन इज सिलेक्टेड फॉर अ पर्टिकुलर शिप टाइप। सो फ्रेंड्स, सर्वेयर वोंट बी आस्किंग दिस क्वेश्चन डायरेक्टली, बट इंस्टेड ही विल आस्क यू एक्सप्लेन द इंजन लेआउट डायग्राम और इंजन लोड डायग्राम, विच इज ऑल्सो कॉल्ड द प्रोपेलर कर्व। सो इंस्टेड ऑफ आस्किंग दिस क्वेश्चन डायरेक्टली, ही विल आस्क यू दिस क्वेश्चन, these explain these curves. So friends, before I begin with this video, do subscribe to my channel and share it with your friends to maintain this channel of sharing knowledge. Now let's see this question in detail and look into the these curves in detail. So the steps involved in selecting main engine for a particular ships are given in this spiral. As we can see, the first step is resistance. The second step is the required power. So after resistance is calculated, required power from the resistance is calculated. Then margins are added to this required power. Then after that, the MCR point is marked, and the engine layout diagram is selected with the help of the CAS software, which is provided by the tool, which is provided by the man VNW. Then the particular engine type is selected based on this result, CES result. Then we have to check that the time it takes, the time the main engine takes to cross this barred speed range, that is to avoid the excessive vibration. Then we have to plot the engine load diagram, taking into consideration the power take out or power take in, that is the if the main engine is also provided with shaft generator, or it is provided with motor, so that the power can be taken to boost the boost up the main engine power. And the last point is the compliance, that is it should comply with the NOx, SOx and other requirements or regulations for maneuvering. So all these 8 points will need to be considered in selecting the main engine for a particular ship type. Now let's see each step in detail. So the first step is the establishing the establish the calm weather resistance or propeller diameter or propeller working conditions. So resistance, as we know, can be found out with the help of calculations or the formulas. Basically, there are three types of resistance, as we can see: frictional resistance, residual resistance and the air resistance. So these resistance are calculated with the help of formula or the tank test, that is by towing tank test. The model of the ship is towed in a tank and all the resistance are calculated. So this is how the resistance for the ship are calculated. Then selecting the number of blades required for the particular ship. So as you can see that the number of propeller blades can be calculated by this formula, as you can see over here. And as you can see in this graph, for this RPM 105, as you can see, as we change the number of blades, as the number of blades are reduced, like over C, like 3, 4, 5 and 6, the propeller efficiency increases. So the lesser the number of blades, the higher the propeller efficiency. So mostly we select 4 number of blades or 5 number of blades. And a second point is the calculation of light propeller curve, which gives a requirement for the power or design power. So this is the initial this project stage, which is used for estimating the necessary propeller power or the propeller RPM, which is based on the theoretical calculations on the calm weather resistance for the loaded ship and the propeller working conditions behind the hull. So this power, this PD is calculated. Resistance Calculations are typically validated and design is further optimized by the experiment Turing test, as I have already explained you in the last slides. The combination of propeller speed and the power obtained from the light propeller curve at the this engine's design speed can be termed as propeller design point. So from the tank test, this light propeller curve is drawn, this curve is drawn, and the design point, the propeller design point, is marked on this curve, as we can see PD over here. So as this point PD is marked on this propeller light propeller design curve, to this we add C margin. So C margin is basically because of the fouled hull or the heavy weather conditions. So for that, extra power will be needed to avoid this propeller into heavy running. So C margin is basically 10 to 30%, and it is added to the light propeller curve or the propeller design point. So finally we come to point PD dash. When determining the necessary engine power, it is normal practice to add extra power margin, that is also called the C margin, as I have already told. Then once we have got this point PD dash, then in that we add engine margin, which is 10 to 30%. So the 100% utilization of engine power is not desirable in normal operations, as it thermal stresses or many other, or due to vibrations. So 100% power of the engine we cannot use at all the times. So for that, engine margin is also added, which is also 10 to 30%. So after adding engine margin, we come to this point LP, that is which is also on the light propeller curve. So this point LP includes C margin as well as the engine margin. Then the third margin which we add is the light running margin, which is 4 to 7%. This 4 to 7% was actually previously used, but now this margin has been extended, or now the its value is 10 to 15%. Reason for that I will tell you at the in upcoming slides. So the fouled hull, which changes the wake field, reduces the speed of the arriving water and increases the slip of the propeller, taking it more heavy running. So heavy sheaves will increase the resistance. So for that purpose, this light running margin is added. So for that, this LP point is shifted by 10 to 30% in towards the left, and we get the curve, which is the engine layout curve, this curve, and the point which we get is the MP, that is the point M, the or the specific what is the name of the point, this maximum continuous rating point, SMCR is this MP point. Now the fourth step in selection of this engine is we have to plot this SMCR point on the engine layout diagram for various possible engine types. For example, by using the online calculation tool CEAS, or Computerized Engine Application System, which this is the tool provided by the Man VNW. It is there on the on their website. So by using this site, we will fill up all the requirements, all our requirements, and accordingly we get this graph, which shows the engine layout diagrams for different engines, and this is the this SMCR point. So accordingly we have to select the engine. Often more than one engine, as you can see, delivers the this SMCR point for the calculated project. So the location of SMCR point within the layout diagram for these engines will provide vital information as to which engine will be the most beneficial. So we have to select the engine from these engines which provided by this tool, CASS tool. So now before we go further, let me explain you the diagram which we have plotted for different engines. So that diagram is the engine layout diagram. So this basically this the basic engine layout diagram can have its SMCR point within the limit L1, L2, L3 and L4. This line L1 and L2 and L3 and L4 limits the speed of the engine. So these lines basically limit the speed of the engine. And this L1, L3 and L2, L4, these are the constant mean effective pressure lines, or the maximum and the minimum MEP lines. So depending upon the engine type, L2, L4 will typically be 75 to 80% of the maximum MEP. So this is this value, this line is 70 to 80% of the maximum mean effective pressure line. So mean effective pressure, this mean effective pressure is important parameter for understanding engine layout diagram. It is an expression for how much power the engine delivers related to the displacement volume of the engine and rotational speed. Maximum continuous rating. We have in this diagram, with the help of this diagram, I'll tell you the terms which we normally use in our day-to-day language, but we don't understand their importance. So maximum continuous rating, that we have already told you, this point MP is the maximum continuous point. This maximum continuous rating, that is the MCR point, is the maximum power engine can continuously deliver. Then we have nominal maximum continuous rating. So this nominal continuous maximum rating is this point L1, this point. So this L1 point designates the engine's nominal maximum continuous rating, NMCR, and is the maximum power the engine typically can deliver depending upon the number of cylinders. So this is the maximum power engine can deliver, nominal maximum continuous rating. This L1 point is the this represents the NMCR point. Then the specified maximum continuous rating. So within the layout diagram, there are no restrictions to the location of SMCR point, this MP point. The location of SMCR within the load diagram will influence the fuel oil consumption of the engine. So this specified MCR point, SMCR point, can be selected anywhere in this diagram, but it is selected taking into consideration the SFOC for the engine. So this point can be selected anywhere in the diagram, but for that point engine will be working safely, but SFOC will be very high for all the points. So we have to select specific location where the SFOC will be minimum. Then we have normal continuous rating. Normal continuous rating, or this point S, is the power needed in service including the specified C margin and light running margin. So this point, this SP, is the point S. So basically this includes this C margin. The point S is identical to service propulsion point SP unless the main engine driven shaft generator. This point is actually this SP is the point in which this C margin is added. But in case the engine is also used to drive the shaft generator, then this point may be requiring more power and it will shift towards the MP. Then we come on to the third point, that is based on the CES result, we have to select the engine depending upon the priority of the project. So several layout diagrams of the engine that includes the example of SMCR point are displayed over here, and as we can see, so different priorities of the project will result in different optimal speed. So sometime the speed is the priority, sometime the fuel oil consumption is the priority. So accordingly we have to select the engine type from this diagram. So the engine design capable of delivering the largest power at SMCR RPM can be derated the most, resulting in reduced fuel consumption, but will typically also have the highest initial cost and larger dimensions. So what this point is trying to say is that we can select a point which will have derated value, that is reduced SFOC. So SFOC, the specific fuel consumption will be less, but for that there will be higher initial cost and the dimensions will be also larger. So we have to take into consideration these points. It's not like we simply reduce this SFOC, but we have to pay something for that. That is the initial cost, and it may also require the large dimensions. Sometimes other parameters such as engine dimensions can have a greater priority, as I have already told you, than the fuel oil consumption. Engine length and width can be a challenge for the smaller ships. So accordingly, we have basically our main objective for selection of engine has to be clear in mind. That is, if SFOC is there, SFOC is the main criteria, then that we have to consider, or length, width, or other things. Then accordingly, we have to select the engine type. So after selection, the particular engine type for a speed, suppose these are the constant speed lines for a ship, and if we want to reduce or increase the diameter of the propeller, as we can see over here, so these are constant diameter for the propeller. Suppose this MCR point is lying over here after calculation for this 15 knots. Then for the same speed, there could be other this MCR point, and for that engines will be different. For engine, the engines will be different. So to achieve this same speed, we have to change the diameter of the propeller. So there is a this graph provides the flexibility in selecting the engine with respect to the diameter of the propeller with a constant ship speed. So friends, till now I have covered this engine layout diagram in detail, and how to plot this SMCR point on the engine layout diagram and selecting the particular engine type. Now we have to check, after selecting the engine, this SMCR point, or drawing the this light propeller curve, we have to check whether this barred speed range is crossed by, sorry, this is the barred speed range. Actually, this is the engine load diagram that I will explain you in upcoming slides. But as this steps involve this six number steps involve involve this barred speed range crossing, so that's why I am taking this diagram right now. So we in over here we have to check that this line, this Bollard pull curve, it has to cross this barred range, so that it has to pass this barred speed range very quickly, so that there is not enough vibration, or the engine is basically not damaged. So this range has to be passed very quickly. So we have to check this thing in the engine this load diagram. Let me read it out for you. At the start of acceleration from zero speed, the propeller will be heavy running and operating along the Bollard pull curve. So when engine is starting or accelerating, it won't be following this engine layout curve. Instead, it will be following Bollard pull curve. So it is clear that due to heavy running of the propeller in the Bollard pull, 100% RPM cannot be reached. As you can see, this is the limit for the engine. So if this full engine RPM, that is, if this is the requirement for the engine RPM, so this, by using the engine cannot achieve this 100% RPM by following this Bollard pull curve. So the barred speed range imposed by the vibration must be passed sufficiently quick, as I told you, in order not to damage the shaft due to vibration resulting in excessive stress. So we have to avoid this barred speed range, and we have to pass it very quickly, as quickly as possible. So for that, this intersection point over here, actually it should be this point. Basically, we have to see this point. This point has to be crossing this barred speed range. So it should lie over here. The curve should pass like this. So by this way, the Bollard this barred speed range can be quickly passed. इफ द बुलार्ड पुल कर्व क्रॉसेस द पावर लिमिट फॉर द इंजन एट आरपीएम बिलो और विद इन दिस बुलार्ड स्पीड रेंज सॉरी बार्ड स्पीड रेंज द बार्ड स्पीड रेंज मे नॉट पास सफिशेंट क्विकली एज वी कैन सी इन दिस डायग्राम इफ दिस दिस कर्व इज पासिंग इन बिटवीन ओनली ओवर हेयर ओनली सो दिस पार्ट इट वोंट बी क्रॉसिंग वेरी क्विकली सो इन दैट केस देर विल बी लॉट ऑफ वाइब्रेशन सो वी हैव टू चेक दिस कर्व इट शुड क्रॉस दिस दिस रेंज बार्ड स्पीड रेंज ओके सो इन ऑर्डर टू अवॉइड इशू विद द स्लो पैसेज ऑफ बार्ड स्पीड रेंज द इंजन पावर एंड द प्रोपेलर करेक्टरिस्टिक्स शुड बी मैच अकॉर्डिंगली नाउ इट्स टाइम फॉर दिस लोड डायग्राम और द प्रोपेलर कर्व सो बिफोर दैट लेट मी tell you about the log scale which we are going to use for the this load diagram so as we can see this diagram this represents the straight line y equals to ax plus b okay so this is the power equation for the power where c is the constant and p is the mean effective pressure and n is the RPM. From the propeller law, the power can be written as PB is equal to C into N power 3. So from these two equations, we can see that if this mean effective pressure is kept constant, then this can be written as PB is equal to C into N ka power I. I can be 1, 2, 3, 4, anything. Okay. And taking log on this scale, on this equation, both side, then we can see log PB is equals to I into log N plus log C. So log C, this equation basically represents a straight line. As we can see, this is Y. Log PB is Y. Then I into log N. Log N is X and log C is a constant value. So basically, this equation is I. So this equation is actually a straight line. So as we can see by changing this value of I, we can get different straight lines. So this is for I equal to 0, we get this straight line. For I equal to 1, we get this straight line. I equals to 2, we get this straight line. And for I equals to 3, we get this straight line. So as we can see for I equals to 3, this propeller law, we get this straight line if we take log. Okay. So this is what I wanted to explain you by this. So this is basically used in the load diagram, engine load diagram. So this diagram is basically log scale, percentage of speed and this engine power. That is why we are getting straight lines. Mostly this diagram is like this, this diagram. But to make this line straight and make it more easier to understand, we convert it into log scale. So now let me explain you this load diagram. This load diagram defines the power and the speed limitation for continuous as well as overload operation of an installed engine which has a specified MCR point M that confirms the ship's specification. Normally the point M is equal to MCR propulsion point MP, but in case where the shaft generator is installed, this point M may incorporate the engine power required for the ship propulsion MP and the shaft generator SG. So as we can see, this point basically is talking about this point M, as we have already drawn this point on the engine layout diagram. So now this point is also drawn on the this engine load diagram. So this point can be different in case this shaft generator is also installed on the ship. So during shop test running, the engine will always operate along the curve 1 with 100% SMCR. So this is the curve 1. During shop test, engine will run and follow this curve. Continuous service range is limited by the line 4, 5, 7 and 3 or 9. So this is the line 4. Then this is the line 5, this is the constant MEP, that is mean effective pressure line. देन दिस इज द मैक्सिमम पावर लाइन लाइन 7 एंड दिस इज द स्पीड लिमिटेशन फॉर दिस शिप फॉर द इंजन. सो लाइन 3 और लाइन 9 दिस लाइन. सो द इंजन कैन बी सेफली ऑपरेटेड कंटिन्यूस इन कैन बी कंटिन्यूसली ऑपरेटेड इन दिस रेंज. So line, now let me explain you about line 3 and line 9. Line 3 represents the maximum acceptable speed for a continuous operation. So this line, line 3 and line 9. So line 3 will represent the maximum acceptable speed for continuous operation, that is 105% of M. During sea trial condition, the maximum speed may be extended to 107, which is line 9, this line. The above limit may in general be extended to 105% and during the sea trial to 107% of nominal L1 speed of the engine. So as I told you, L1 point which was on the engine layout diagram. So in this diagram, they are telling about the percentage with respect to point M, but this can be also extended with respect to the point L1, as we have already explained in previous slides. So this percentage can be with respect to point L1, so 107 and 105, and the overspeed set point is 109% of M1. However, it may be moved to 109% of point L1. So this L1 is actually the maximum point where the M can be placed. So either percentage is taken with respect to the M, which is inside the load layout diagram, or it is with respect to the maximum point, that is the L1 point, now this line 4. This line 4 represents the limit at which the ample air supply is available for the combustion and impose a limitation on the maximum combustion of the torque and the speed. So this line 4 basically represents the capacity of the turbocharger. So this turbocharger is providing the maximum supply of air it can provide for the particular engine, and accordingly that provides the maximum torque and the speed combination. Then we come on to line number 5. As we can see, this is 100% MCR MEP line. So this part is actually number 5. So this represents the maximum mean effective pressure level which can be accepted for a continuous operation. Then line 7 represents the maximum power for a continuous operation. So this line is 100% power point, power maximum power for continuous operation. This is actually 100% power. Then line 10 represents the mean effective pressure line. Line 10, this line is actually 110% of mean effective pressure line for the engine. Then come on to line number 8, which represents the overload operation of the limitations. So this line, line 8. This line 8 represents the overload operation limit. So the area between the lines 4, 5, 7 and 8 is available for overload running for limited period, that is 1 hour per 24 hour, per 12 hours. So this black portion over here, this black portion covered by the line this 4, 5, 7 and 8 represents the overload operation of the engine. In order to safeguard the diesel engine against the thermal and mechanical overload, approved electronic governor includes the following two limiter functions, the torque limiter and the scavenged air limiter. So to avoid the engine to operate in this area, there are two functions provided in the governor, that is, one is the torque limiter and the other is the scavenger pressure limiter. So now let's discuss these two limiters in detail. First is the torque limiter. The purpose of the torque limiter is to ensure that the limitation line on the load diagram are always absorbed. The torque limiter algorithm compares the calculated fuel pump index and actual measured engine speed with reference to the limiter curve, giving the maximum allowable fuel pump index at a engine given speed. So this algorithm compares the fuel pump index and the speed and accordingly adjust the actual fuel pump index so that this torque can be limited. If the calculated fuel pump index is above this curve, the resulting fuel pump index will be reduced correspondingly. The reference limiter curve is to be adjusted so that it corresponds to the limitation line of this load diagram. So we have to set the limit point so that the engine should operate within this area and it should not enter this dark area. Second is the scavenger pressure limiter. So the purpose of scavenger pressure limiter is to ensure that the engine is not being overfouled during acceleration, as for example during maneuvering. So this is basically provided for the maneuvering purpose. The scavenger, so that this extra fuel is not injected when air pressure, scavenger pressure is not sufficient. The scavenger pressure limiter algorithm compares the calculated fuel pump index and measures the scavenger pressure with reference to the limiter curve given, giving the maximum allowable fuel pump index at a given scavenger pressure. If the calculated fuel pump index is above this curve, the resulting fuel pump index will be reduced correspondingly. So as I already explained you, so this algorithm basically calculates the fuel pump index and measures the scavenger pressure, and if this fuel pump index is more than the actual scavenger pressure, then the fuel pump index will be reduced. So the reference limiter curve is to be adjusted to ensure that a sufficient air will always be available for the good combustion process. So these two limiters are provided in the governor so that engine is avoided in running this dark shaded area. Now we come on the conclusion. So let me revise this thing for you. So basically the area which is covered by the line 4, 5, 7 and 3 or 9 provides the 3 provides the area for normal operation, and the area between the 4, 5, 7 and 8 is the overload operation. Then line 4 is the torque and the speed limit for the maximum air available. Then line 5 is the maximum MEP line. Then 100% MEP line. Line 7 is the 100% power line. Line 3 is the 105% speed limit. Line 9 is 107 speed limit. And speed set, over speed set limit is 109% of M, or it could be of L1 point, that is the maximum power engine can have. Then line 6 is the light propeller curve. Line 1 is the curve for taking into consideration the C margin and engine margin, and this line is basically followed during C trial conditions. And this line 10 is the 110% of mean effective pressure line. So these lines are constant MEP lines. So this is what is there in the this engine load diagram or the propeller curve. So let's see the recommendations, what this manufacturer, actually I have already explained you the recommendations, but let me read it for you to make it more simpler. Continuous operation without a time limitation is allowed only within the area 4, 5, 7 and 3 of the load diagram, as I have already told. For fixed pitch propeller, operation in calm weather with a loaded ship and clean hull, the propeller engine may run along or close to the propeller design curve 6. This one, this 6 light, that is the propeller light curve. After some time in operation, the ship's hull and the propeller will become fouled, resulting in heavier running of the propeller, that is the propeller curve will move to the left from line 6 towards line 2, that is this one. And extra power will be required for the propulsion in order to maintain the ship speed. At calm weather condition, the extent of heavy running of the propeller will indicate the need for cleaning the hull and possible polishing of the propeller. So basically this thing chief engineer can himself find out, because if he knows the power taken by the engine, so if he knows the power and if we plot this power on this graph, then he will get the corresponding speed. But if its speed is less, then he will come to know that propeller is fouled. Suppose this is the power and corresponding speed is this one, but if speed is over here, actual speed is over here, it's not this speed, then he will come to know that the propeller and the hull is fouled. The area between the line 1, line 4 and 1 is available for the operation in shallow water, heavy weather or during acceleration. That is for non-steady operation within without any actual time limitation. So basically this area is for acceleration, not the dark shaded area. This area between the 4, 1 and this 4 and 1, the area which is available is for acceleration and for heavy running and during when ship is operating in shallow waters. So basically this is for continuous operation, but in this case the SFOC will not be considered. Let me explain you this point with one more example. That is, once this MEP, that the point M is marked on this load diagram, as we can see over here, layout diagram, the load diagram can be drawn and hence the actual load limitations line of the diesel engine can be found. So after this M is drawn on the layout diagram, then we have to draw this load diagram on this layout diagram. So as we can see, from M we have to draw this line. This is a light propeller curve, then speed limit, and then this four, this stroke and speed limit, then the overload. So we have to draw all these lines in the layout diagram so that we come to know that the operating or the points for the engine. Now the last thing is the eighth is the this compliance. So basically this actually needs a detailed explanation, but as this video is getting too long, then I'll try to cover it in some other MARPOL chapter. But basically this point is that the engine should comply with NOx and SOx legislations, as well as the engine efficiency design index, and the ship should be capable of maneuvering ability safely in all conditions. So these are the compliance so that ship can be safely operated and it should meet the MARPOL or MARPOL requirements. So thank you friends, hope this video will be very helpful for you. And this video, this question, mostly surveyor won't be asking you directly, but instead they will ask you the engine layout curve or the engine load curve, or instead they will ask the propeller curve. This load curve and the propeller curve are mostly the same. So hope till then, take care, have fun.